Hello, with Annette here. Welcome to another of my videos about movie production gone wrong. Sometimes it is not the cost that hinders a movie, it is the extras. The Little Minister. Directed by Richard Wallace, this 1934 drama movie is based on J.M. Barrie's 1891 novel, which is titled same as the movie, which later became a play in 1897. While the movie was the fifth in the franchise, the four movies beforehand were silent. The Little Minister was the third novel to be published from the Thrum novels. J.M. Barrie based all his novels on his hometown of Kurimui, which helped J.M. Barrie to his fame. The premiere of this movie took place at New York City's Radio City Music Hall. A triple CD box set of the movie's soundtrack was released, which includes 10 tracks by composer Max Steiner. Also, the soundtrack included songs that originated from Scotland, which are Coming Through the Rye, House of Argyle and The Bonnie Banks o' Loch Lomond. Margaret Sullivan was offered the role of playing Babby when Audrey Hepburn rejected the role, however Audrey changed her mind, so was given the part. Leland Haywood, Audrey's agent, was not impressed with her taking the role. Most of the filming took place on RKO's 40 acres lot, where a set was built at the back of the studios. Some of the filming also took place at Laurel Canyon and in California's Sherwood Forest. The total budget for this movie was $650,000, which was the most expensive film made in the year, and the most expensive movie Audrey ever starred in. Although, it is not the cost that places this movie in my video, it is the filming. John Beale, who played Reverend Gavin Dishart, was accidentally stabbed in the eye by an extra during filming the mob scene. Being a director of a movie for the first time, definitely brings bad points as well as good. Citizen Kane. Directed by Orson Welles, who found fame after his 1938 radio broadcast on CBS Radio, which was created by Orson's Mercury Theatre, which was founded in 1937 with Herman by Orson's side. The broadcast of War of the Worlds also caused so much controversy. People who turned on their radios in mid-broadcast of the play actually thought the world was being attacked by aliens and caused panic amongst many citizens. After Orson was approached by many people from Hollywood as early as 1936, he turned down three scripts sent to him by Warner Brothers. Before he decided to sign a contract with RKO on August 21, 1939. After the studio head George J. Scaffer had approached Orson, at first Orson declined George's offer, but as Orson got himself in debt, he decided to take a tour around RKO Studios on July 20, 1939. RKO was struggling at the time, so they were only interested in independent directors. Orson originally only wanted to spend 3 months in Hollywood to pay off his debts. RKO and Orson's contract was highly resented by the media. The Hollywood press mocked their partnership. One reporter even wrote, quote, "They are laying bets over the RKO lot that Orson Welles' deal will end up without Orson ever doing a picture there," which was written after failed productions by Orson after spending 3 months with RKO. George J. Scaffer, on the other hand, believed in Orson. Citizen Kane was released in 1941. This drama has been known as the best movie ever made by critics. Herman J. Mankiewicz, who was the co-writer of the screenplay with Orson Welles, won an Academy Award for Best Writing. Even though people became controversial with who actually wrote Citizen Kane, as Herman was the main writer for Orson's plays that were broadcasted on CBS Radio. In February 1930, Orson gave 300 notes to Herman, with the supervision of John Houseman. Orson left them to it. Herman and John made their own version of the script. Orson did keep writing notes of his own and did consult with Herman. As a director, Orson did the right thing by keeping his own works in the production as well as adding those by Herman. As Herman had no contract with RKO, he was not going to be credited for his work. This made Herman really annoyed and threatened to take full-page advertisements in trade papers. Herman also knew a man called Ben Hecht, who worked for the Saturday Evening Post to write an article about Orson and RKO. Herman also threatened to the Screenwriters Guild and claim full credit for writing the script. After RKO awarded Herman with being credited, he withdrew his accusations from the Screenwriters Guild. In the original credit list, Herman was second in the list till Orson pencil marked an arrow to position Herman first. Even the ending credits people can see that Herman is the first name to appear as a screenwriter. Over the next 12 years of Herman's life, himself and Orson had a strong friendship. The movie follows the life of Orson Welles' character Christopher Foster Kane, who was an American journalist. Even Orson Welles added aspects of his own life as a screenwriter in the movie. When this movie was released, William Randolph Hearst, a high-end media baron of the time, refused Citizen Kane to be mentioned in his newspaper, due to the main character being loosely based on William's life. Herman knew William personally before Herman was thrown out of William's social circle, which caused Herman to hold so much hate against William. It was unusual for an untried director to write and produce his own movie, and choose the cast, which Orson was hoping to cast those he had already worked with from the Mercury Theatre, which did not plan out as expected. Charlie Chaplin recommended Dorothy Cumming Gore to Orson. Dorothy discovered Charlie and helped him to fame. Plus, Dorothy had played supporting parts in movies since 1934. At a party in Los Angeles for Dorothy and Orson met, and he liked what he saw and added Dorothy to the cast immediately. Dorothy played Kane's second wife, Susan Alexander Kane, although in the credits Dorothy appears as Linda Winters. While Orson was on a break in New York, he met a woman named Ruth Warwick, who was a stage actress at the time. Orson knew she would be good to play the part of Kane's first wife, Emily Monroe Norton Kane. Due to Ruth seeing a picture of Orson's mother, Beatrice Ives Wells, Ruth noticed they looked so similar, so Ruth acted as motherly as possible during production. Westbrook Van Harris asked to be in the production as a reporter in the movie. Westbrook also asked for $25,000 before he actually became casted for the production. William Aland imitated Westbrook for his cheekiness. Orson overheard William's imitation and decided to give William the role of the reporter Jerry Thompson. For the production of the movie, Orson watched many movies repeatedly to understand the producing side of films, and he repeatedly asked questions about how certain scenes were filmed. Greg Toland, who worked as a cinematographer, approached Orson in his office and asked if he could be part of the production, with Orson being completely new to film production. Orson agreed, and after a few words, RKO hired Greg as a loan from Samuel Goldwyn Productions when filming was in its first week in June 1940. RKO executives were not allowed to see the production until it was completed, as Orson did not want anyone to interfere with his production. Which RKO did comply, as long as Orson did not exceed $500,000. When RKO visited the set on June 29, 1940, when filming began, they did not know filming was going ahead, as Orson lied to them by saying they were doing camera tests. The executives were also pushing Orson to start directing a movie called The Men from Mars to capitalize on Orson's radio broadcast War of the Worlds at the time. Orson had to tell the executives that he would direct the movie later. He wanted to concentrate on something different. Orson did run scene tests in the movie. One of those was the news on the March projection room scene, which was filmed in the dark. The budget for this was $528. Orson exceeded that by spending $809. In the end, RKO agreed with Orson about his testing scenes, as his scenes were rehearsed before filming commenced, which had never been done before in movie production. The nightclub scene took 10 to 12 days to complete. In this scene, Kane's second wife Susan attempts to commit suicide. They sprayed chemicals in Dorothy Cummings' throat to give her a raspy voice. Some of the filming took place at Balboa Park in San Diego and also San Diego Zoo. Some stage scenes were filmed at Scenic Studios, but most of the filming took place at RKO Studios, to what is now known as Paramount Pictures. Orson typically woke up at 4 a.m. to start filming the production, as makeup normally took 4 hours to apply. These early starts meant Orson spent 16 to 18 hours a day on filming. A doctor had to be employed to insert contact lenses in Orson's eyes. Those that were there later said it looked excruciating, but they were needed to make Orson look old. Orson could barely see anything once the contacts were in. During the scene where Kane smashes up the furniture in Susan's bedroom, Orson accidentally cuts his wrist. Orson quickly improvises and grabs the curtain on set to cover the wound. This detail can also be seen in the movie. In another scene, Orson is standing on the staircase in Susan's apartment complex. Orson shouted at Ray Collins' character, Jim W. Gettys, Kane's rival. While doing so, Orson accidentally fell 10 feet, which caused Orson to be in a wheelchair for 2 weeks after an X-ray showed Orson had chipped his ankle. For Orson to commence filming his scenes, he had to wear a brace, which became evident while filming a low angle in a scene. While filming at Scenic Studios, which had its own burning furnace equipped inside, multiple takes were needed to perfect a sled being put in the fire. The local Culver City Fire Department had to be called, due to the flue becoming too hot and caught fire. The initial production was finalized on October 24th, refilming had to commence on November 15th. Greg Toland had to leave the production at this point due to other commitments, so he was replaced by Harry J. Wild, who worked at RKO as a cinematographer. The final scene was Kane's death, which commenced on the 30th of November, which was the day the movie was fully wrapped. The estimated budget of this movie was $723,800. According to RKO, the full production cost $839,727. Even though critics did enjoy the movie overall, Citizen Kane failed to bring in profit. Over the years, this movie faded away till a man called André Bazin, a French critic, released the movie again in 1956. On September 13, 2011, the movie was released again on Blu-ray as a special 75th anniversary edition. Citizen Kane became preserved in the United States National Film Registry for being culturally and historically important after being nominated by the Library of Congress in 1989 as an inductee of an inaugural group of 25 films. Some directors are tough cookies when it comes to money. The Crusades. Directed by Cecil B. DeMille, this 1935 adventure was originally released by Paramount Pictures. This movie stars Henry Wilcoxon, who plays England's Richard I, and Loretta Young, who plays Berengaria of Navarre. The Crusades was nominated for an award for Victor Milner's cinematography. In 1935 at the Venice Film Festival, it was nominated for Best Foreign Film. During production, the stuntmen started to demand that Cecil should give them a pay rise. This was due to horses and riders falling into a moat during filming a battle scene. The riders were hospitalized and the horses was euthanized. Cecil refused to give the stuntmen any rise in pay, as he accused them of messing up a simple scene. On occasions, filming scenes of war can make people seem like they are in war. They died with their boots on. Raoul Walsh directed this 1941 black and white western, which follows the story of George Armstrong Custer, who joins the military academy in West Point, fights in the American Civil War, and when the Battle of the Little Bighorn commences, George Armstrong Custer is killed. The Battle of the Little Bighorn was filmed in a rural area just outside of Los Angeles, which was not Raoul's original idea. Raoul hoped that he could film the scene at the location where the battle had taken place, which is in Southern California. The saber charge by George and his men is depicted in the movie as George being the last man alive with his comrades dead around him. The evidence found on site where the actual battle took place, George was most probably one of the first men to die. George was also portrayed as having long hair in the movie, where in reality George had short hair. George was also portrayed as being a dashing figure who is fun-loving, and chooses glory and honor over corruption and money. There were relatives of George's that fought in the Battle of the Little Bighorn that were never mentioned in this movie: Boston, who was George's brother, along with James Calhoun, George's brother-in-law, Henry Reed, George's nephew, and also George's other brother Thomas, who all died in the battle. The Battle of the Little Bighorn was against Lakota's war leader Chief Crazy Horse, who was portrayed as a crooked deal between military corruption and politicians. He fights for the land that was promised to the Native Americans by George Custer. Chief Crazy Horse was played by Anthony Quinn, who was the only main Native American actor in the movie. The other Native Americans were only extras, and there were 16 in all from the Sioux tribe. The rest of the natives in this movie were acted by Filipino extras. Also, evidence and Native American accounts proved that the men were involved in the Battle of the Little Bighorn. The sabers were boxed before battle commenced and they were sent to the rear of the troops. Warner Brothers announced the screenplay in 1941, which was written with Errol in mind. Many people confused this movie with Michael Curtiz's Santa Fe Trail, which Errol Flynn did star in the role of Jeb Stuart. Olivia de Havilland also starred in Santa Fe Trail as Errol's leading lady, while Ronald Reagan played the role of George Armstrong Custer in Santa Fe Trail. They Died With Their Boots On was the eighth and final collaboration between Errol, who played George Armstrong Custer, and Olivia, who played Elizabeth Bacon Custer. During filming in September 1941, Errol collapsed due to exhaustion. While filming the cavalry charge under artillery fire, Jack Budlong insisted on using a real saber, as the explosions made the horse buck, which caused Jack to fall. Instead of Jack falling onto the ground, he accidentally fell onto his saber, which killed him. During production, a stuntman died of a heart attack and another man fell off his horse and broke his neck, which killed him. They Died With Their Boots On was one of the top-grossing movies in 1941. Max Steiner composed the soundtrack for the movie. He also used George Armstrong Custer's favorite song Garoyowen, that he became to know while in West Point, when an English soldier was playing the song on piano. Garoyowen is a typical Irish song that is normally sung by drunk men. This song has been used in many movies due to the galloping rhythm for cavalry scenes. Saratoga. Directed by Jack Conway, this romantic comedy became the most successful film for Metro-Goldwyn-Mayer in 1937. According to the records held by MGM, Saratoga made a profit of $1,146,000. After production costs, which was a build-up from Canada and other countries that made $820,000, in the United States the movie made $2,432,000. Filming took place in Kentucky's Lexington and Louisville, as well as New York's Saratoga Springs. Robert Hopkins wrote the script with Gene Harlow in mind, but Jack wanted someone else to play Gene's part. Jack tried to borrow Carol Lombard from Paramount Pictures, but due to contract difficulties, Jack was not able to do so. Jack then set eyes on recruiting Joan Crawford to play Jean's role. Unfortunately, that fell through, as Jean was a better actress, so in 1937 Jack had no choice but to bring Jean into the production. This movie is the sixth collaboration for Clark Gable and Gene Harlow, and became the highest-grossing production of Gene's career. While filming was underway, Jean was suffering from oral surgery as she had her wisdom teeth removed. When the production was 90% completed, a scene was being filmed with Jean and actor Walter Pidgeon, who played Hartley Madison. When Jean collapsed, Jean had been suffering with sun poisoning, and alongside the problems with her wisdom teeth, Jean died in hospital of kidney failure. MGM wanted to film the full production over again, by recruiting Jean Arthur or Eugenia Bruce to take Jean Harlow's role. Instead, the decision was made for Mary D to stand in front of the cameras as Jean Harlow, but Mary's face was covered or her back was turned to the camera. Paula Winslow was also recruited to be the voice of Jean Harlow. It was not quite 7 weeks after Jean Harlow's death when the movie was released on July 23, 1937. Many flocked to the cinemas to see Saratoga. Despite many of Jean Harlow's fans struggling with her loss, the critics mainly had positive reviews of the movie. A shame Jean Harlow was not able to enjoy the money from production. Jean was in a relationship with one of MGM's top actors, William Powell, when she died. Jean asked William to marry her numerous of times, but he rejected her offering every time. Before Jean was in a relationship with William, Jean was married to Harold Rosen, who worked as a movie director. Harold and Jean divorced after only 1 year of marriage. Jean was married to another director, Paul Byrne, before she married Harold. Paul suspiciously died years before Jean met Harold. Also during production, Lionel Barrymore, who played Grandpa Clayton, was on set. He tripped over a wire, which caused Lionel to break his hip for the second time during his career, which caused Lionel to be in a wheelchair. Thank you for listening. If you like my content, please like and subscribe. To keep up to date with future videos, then press that notification bell. Alternatively, follow me on Twitter @withanet1.